Good morning. Would you please turn your Bibles with me to Nehemiah chapter 9, verses 13 through 17. You came down on Mount Sinai. You spoke them from the heaven. You gave them regulations and laws that are just and right, and decrees and commands that are good. You made known to them your holy Sabbath and gave them commands, decrees, and laws through your servant Moses. In their hunger you gave them bread from heaven, and in their thirst you brought them water from the rock. You told them to go in and take possession of the land you had sworn with uplifted hand to give them. But they, our forefathers, became arrogant and stiff-necked, and did not obey your commands. They refused to listen and failed to remember the miracles you performed among them. They became stiff-necked and in their rebellion appointed a leader in order to return to their slavery. But you are a forgiving God, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. Therefore, you did not desert them.
Am I on? All right, this was working this morning, so I hope I've got voice left after the class this morning. But it's good to see everybody, and it's always a delight to worship with brothers and sisters in Christ. As you know, Terry and Nancy are visiting their grandkids in Washington State. Now, I offered to show them pictures of my grandkids, but that wasn't enough for them, and I just don't really understand that. But that's where they are. They're up there now. Today's sermon is one I preached here on a Sunday night, maybe 7 years ago. And I'm preaching it again, not because I don't have anything else to say, some of you may think that, but because I love preaching it, and I thought it might be helpful for more of you to hear it. Now, if you're one of the few who were here that night, and one of the fewer who remember anything about the sermon, I'm still hoping that you can benefit from a reminder. Now, if you happen to have total recall of the sermon, maybe it's not too late for you to fake a seizure. Those who are familiar with the work of Jim McGuigan will recognize his influence and sometimes even his words. It just so happens that he'll be here next week. Now, I'm speaking from down here because when I did so 2 years ago, it seemed to help me feel more in contact with you. And it might just be because I'm used to teaching the class from down here. But I'm still experimenting with this. I just hope it's not a distraction for you. And may the Lord use the message this morning to His glory. In his book, The Knowledge of the Holy, A.W. Tozer writes, "The history of mankind will probably show that no people has ever risen above its religion, and man's spiritual history will positively demonstrate that no religion has ever been greater than its idea of God. Worship is pure or base as the worshiper entertains high or low thoughts of God. For this reason, the gravest question before the church is always God Himself. And the most portentous fact, the most consequential thing about any man is not what he at a given time may say or do, but what he in his deep heart conceives God to be like." Now, I think that eloquently expresses the tremendous importance of our concept of God, our understanding of his character. What we believe God to be like determines to a large extent our experience of religion. The less accurate our understanding of God's character, the more distorted our religious experience. And I saw that clearly in the life of one of my physical brothers. My brother Buddy served in the Marine Corps in Vietnam during the 1968 Tet Offensive, which some of you will remember was the fiercest fighting in that war. Now, during his 13 months in Vietnam, Buddy did things for which he felt very guilty. Now, I don't know all the weights that comprised his burden of guilt, but one very large weight was his killing of a 12-year-old child. His pain was so great that it was years before he ever spoke of that incident. And when he finally brought it up, our mom tried to, you know, ease his conscience by saying, well, terrible things just happen in war. And all he could say to her was, but you didn't see his face. In 1978, Buddy became a Christian, but he never experienced the release from guilt that God intended him to have. Instead of rejoicing in being liberated, he remained in the torment of David in Psalm 32. My bones wasted away all day long, for day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. And Buddy eventually grew weary of that grind, weary of fighting with a weight of guilt on his back, and from all outward appearances, he ceased to be faithful to God. On July 2nd, 1987, at the age of 39, he died from a ruptured aneurysm in his brain. Now, I tell you this to impress upon you how important it is to know God. My brother suffered greatly because his concept of God was warped. He never felt his forgiveness because he never truly accepted that God is a magnificent forgiver. The God in Buddy's mind was unwilling to forgive sin as terrible as his. At least not until Buddy had paid a sufficient penalty. Until he had suffered enough to bring his sin within forgiving distance. And I'm convinced that my brother's experience is more common than we'd like to think. Maybe some of you in this assembly can relate in your own way to my brother's story. And I want to spend just a few minutes this morning trying to help you to internalize one of the greatest truths of the Bible, the truth that God majors in forgiveness. Now, I'm not one of those who think that preaching of grace is something new in churches of Christ, and it's certainly not new in the Mesa Church. My hope is simply to drive that truth a little deeper into your soul. Now, the Bible from Genesis to Revelation testifies to the fact that forgiveness is a central aspect of God's character. Exodus chapter 34, verses 6 and 7, the Lord passes in front of Moses, proclaiming, the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands, and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. The psalmist declares in Psalm 86:5, you are kind and forgiving, O Lord, abounding in love to all who call on you. In Nehemiah chapter 9, the text that was just read to us, certain Levites, they pray to God, and in verse 17, they say of their forefathers, they became stiff-necked and in their rebellion appointed a leader in order to return to their slavery, but you are a forgiving God, gracious and merciful, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and abounding in love. In Daniel's powerful prayer, in Daniel chapter 9, he says in verse 9, the Lord our God is merciful and forgiving, even though we rebelled against Him. And of course, the ultimate witness to God's forgiving character is the cross of our Lord Jesus. As Jesus said in Matthew chapter 26, verse 28, His blood was poured out for the forgiveness of sins. The cross shouts unambiguously across the centuries that God is a forgiver to the point of having His only Son die. Now, God definitely majors in forgiveness. But the Bible doesn't stop with that basic truth. It elaborates on God's forgiving character in several very important ways. The prophet Micah, he tells us that God not only forgives, but He delights in doing it. Micah chapter 7, verses 18 to 20. It's a hymn of praise in which the prophet brags on the Lord because of His incomparable forgiveness. He says in verses 18 and 19, "Who is a God like You who pardons and forgives the transgression of the remnant of His inheritance? You do not stay angry forever, but delight to show mercy. You will have compassion on us. You will tread our sins underfoot and hurl our iniquities into the depths of the sea." You see, God does not forgive reluctantly. His forgiveness is not something we have to pull from Him, something we've got to drag from Him by convincing Him that we've suffered sufficiently. He forgives eagerly and freely. You think about the parable of the prodigal son in Luke chapter 15. You think about that parable after how that boy treated his father. Upon his return, the father ran to him, threw his arms around him, kissed him, and threw a party. Is that your concept of God? Or do you see God as harboring resentment over your mistreatment of Him, so that the best you can hope for is to maybe get close to Him and then win His forgiveness over time? Is that how you picture God? And we have so much trouble with this, so much difficulty with this, because we're so far from God in this regard. See, because we forgive reluctantly, because that's how we are. Because we forgive reluctantly, we tend to project that onto God. We project our reluctance onto His character. But God says flat out, He says specifically in Isaiah chapter 55, verses 7 and 8, that He is not like us in the matter of forgiving. He's not like we are when it comes to forgiving. The prophet says, "Let the wicked forsake his way, and the evil man his thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord, and He will have mercy on him, and to our God, for He will freely pardon. For, because my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord." I'm not like you when it comes to forgiving. So don't project your reluctance onto me. Well, not only does God delight in forgiving, but the Bible is clear that He forgives completely. He forgives completely. He doesn't forgive mostly. He doesn't maintain a slight grudge. When He forgives, there is complete restoration. It is as though there was never anything to forgive. The completeness of God's forgiveness is reflected in one of the verses we just read. Micah chapter 7, verse 19. You think of what's intended by the image of hurling our iniquities into the depths of the sea. This was before the days of submarines and undersea robots. The bottom of the sea was totally inaccessible. To say something was cast there was to say it was beyond retrieval. It was completely and forever gone. And that same truth is so beautifully expressed poetically in Psalm 103, verse 12. As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us. You don't get farther apart than opposite directions. Again, Isaiah chapter 43, verse 25, God declares, I am He who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sin no more. And remembers your sin no more. Is that how you picture God? Is that how you picture God? Do you really feel that when you've been forgiven, it's as though you never sinned? Or do you feel like you've been knocked to the bottom rung of the ladder and you have to start all over again, laboring to earn your way back to the position where you were before you fell? Do you feel that your forgiven sin leaves a residue that hinders your intimacy with God? It's been forgiven, but there's a ring there that still interferes with and blocks my relationship with God. Someone has said, God doesn't just forgive, He forgets. He erases the board. He destroys the evidence. He burns the microfilm. We are presumptuous, not when we marvel at His grace, but when we reject it. And we're sacrilegious not when we claim His forgiveness, but when we allow the haunting sins of yesterday to convince us that God forgives, but He doesn't forget. Now, in addition to revealing that God delights in forgiving, and that God forgives completely, the Bible makes clear that God forgives repeatedly. The greatest frustration of the devil is that God forgives our sins over and over again. He doesn't have a set number of sins that He will forgive. The issue is the heart. He freely and repeatedly forgives the penitent Christian. In Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 and 22, Peter asked Jesus if he should forgive a brother who sins against him up to seven times. You see, the rabbis pretty much agreed that three times was the limit. So Peter naturally thought he's being very liberal in being willing to forgive up to seven times. And Jesus tells him that he needs to forgive 77 times, or 70 times 7, as some would have it. In other words, he's saying that forgiveness is to be unlimited. There is no magic number. Now, if God requires us to forgive without limit, how much more do you think He'll do so? Or do you think that He requires of us in the matter of forgiveness what He doesn't practice Himself? He forgives repeatedly. 1 John chapter 1, verse 8, through 1 John chapter 2, verse 2, makes very clear that Christians have a continual or repeated cleansing of all sin. 1 John chapter 1, verse 8, John says, if we say that we do not have sin, We deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just so that He forgives us the sins and cleanses us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make Him a liar and His word is not in us. Chapter 2, verse 1. My little children, I write these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. And He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Now you think of 1 John chapter 2, verse 1 in terms of specific sins. John says, my little children, I write these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does engage in adultery, in premarital sex, or in homosexual conduct, but if anyone does consume pornography, get an abortion, or abuse a spouse, but if anyone does lie, cheat, or steal, but if anyone does get drunk or high on drugs, and yes, but if anyone does kill a 12-year-old child, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. You see, Jesus is not a fair weather friend. He doesn't own us or identify with us only when we're excelling spiritually. He's there with us when we fail, when we sin miserably, ready to plead His blood in our defense. And we need to praise God with every fiber of our being that the well of His mercy is never dry for the penitent Christian. For the Christian who has renounced and turned from his sin. And it's when we disgust ourselves that we most need to remember that. Now I know that some of us wince at how boldly the Bible speaks of God's forgiveness. We fear that talking like this will make people casual about sin. And that concern is understandable because sin is an absolute monster. But we cannot withhold the remedy for suffering out of fear the patient will poison himself with it. When I was a young Christian, I heard a preacher, in fact it was Jim McGuigan, I heard a preacher tell about a sailor whose ship docked in the port of some poor Caribbean town. This old woman kept pestering this sailor, wanting him to come and see her dancing dogs. Now she, of course, wanted to get some money for showing him this trick. He put her off and put her off, but she pestered him and pestered him. And finally he said, okay, he would go. So she took him, led him down a road, and then took him through her home, which was essentially a dirt hut. And on the way through there, she grabbed some breadcrumbs from a bowl that was on the counter. And they go into the back of the house. And back there, there's this cage that had several dogs that were on the verge of starvation. You know, the ribs sticking out. Their eyes are bulging. And the old woman, she proceeded to hold the breadcrumbs over the dogs' heads and just out of their reach. And the dogs stood on their hind legs, hoping to receive some sustenance. And she says, do you see my dancing dogs? Do you see my dancing dogs? And Jim said, what an unintentionally cruel thing that woman was doing. But worse by far are those who withhold the grace of God from my brothers in order to get them to work. And I almost fell out of my chair when he said that. Now it's true that we must never, ever trivialize sin or make people casual about it. Sin must be portrayed as the horror and danger that it is, but it's also true that we must not mute the glory of God's grace out of fear. It'll be twisted into a license to sin. Paul was accused of promoting lawlessness by his doctrine of grace. That's what they said about him, but he had never allowed that possible distortion to discourage him from proclaiming the depth of God's mercy. A former missionary to Brazil, he tells the story of a woman named Maria, whose husband died when their only child, Christina, was very young. They lived in a poor neighborhood on the outskirts of a village in Brazil. And Maria, she raised Christina on her own, working as a maid. And when Christina turned 15, she dreamed of making a life for herself in the big city. Now, Mama, Maria knew what would happen to such a beautiful young girl in the city. And she often warned Christina of the cruelty there. But one morning she found Christina's bed empty. So Maria, she gathered some clothes and all the money she had, and she headed for the city. And on her way, she stopped at one of those old photo booths, and she took as many pictures of herself as she could afford. And when she reached the city, she searched for Christina to no avail. Well, she then went to the various hotels that she learned were used by prostitutes, and at each one of those locations, she left behind one of those pictures of herself. One of her pictures she left behind at a conspicuous place. And when her money and the pictures ran out, she returned home. Some months later, Christina, who had in fact become a prostitute, was using one of the hotels her mother had visited. She noticed one of the pictures her mother had left behind, and in tears she pulled it off the bulletin board, and when she turned it over, she found this message on the back: "Whatever you have done, whatever you have become, it doesn't matter. Please come home." And I am telling you this morning that God wrote that same message for us in blood on a cross. Amen. There is no sin of which we repent that is beyond His forgiveness, however terrible, however shameful, however many times we've committed it. God delights in forgiving. He is eager to do it, and when He forgives our sin, it is completely and forever gone. It is just as though we never sinned. Now, if you're a Christian, a baptized believer, and you have come to God in penitence, genuinely sorry for your sin and committed to never doing it again, God has forgiven you. And He intends for you to be released from your guilt. He intends for you to be liberated from your burden so that you might rejoice in the magnificence of His mercy. And I pray that you will experience the Lord's forgiveness, that you will feel the righteousness that He's bestowed on you. And when you do, I pray that you'll go and tell other people what a wonderful thing God has done for you.
Amen.
Now, up to this point, I've been talking to Christians. I've been speaking to people who through faith have been buried and raised with Christ in the waters of baptism. If you've never become a Christian, you're not forgiven. If you've never become a Christian, you're not forgiven. You've refused to accept God's gracious offer of mercy. The burden you feel is very real because you're very guilty. God doesn't want you to feel that way. His Son died so you wouldn't have to feel that way. But you must accept forgiveness as He offers it. You must believe that Jesus, the Son of God, died for your sins, was raised from the dead, ascended to heaven, and is Lord of all. You must commit to to living as He calls you to live, and in that penitent faith, be immersed in water on confession of your faith. Now, if that's where you are in your life, do it today.
That's right.
Do it today. Why wait? Be free. Be reconciled to God. If you're somewhere else in the journey, if you think we can help you in that regard or in any other way, would you please come forward, come to the front as we sing this next song, and you can tell it to one of our shepherds who will be up here.